Good morning. This is truly the day that the Lord hath made, and we are here to rejoice and to be glad in it. We serve a God who is worthy to be praised. I wish to read to you from Psalm 46, which reminds us during this time of turbulence and troubles in life, we have a God who is steady. Psalm 46 says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with the swelling thereof, there is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. This same psalm goes on to remind us that the Lord of hosts is with us. God of Jacob is our refuge. And then it culminates in the words, be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. I tell you, if he says he will be exalted among the heathens, how should he be exalted in the house of the Lord? How do we exalt the Lord our refuge? For he is our help in time of trouble. May we use this day of worship to exalt him and lift him up, for he truly is worthy to be praised.
Good morning, Brentwood. Are we all able to stand? And yes, we are able. Let's all stand and sing the hymn, Are Ye Able, Said the Master.
With me. the great invitation to come to the table. We thank God for the invitation. We will now hear our communion reading from Deacon Garrett.
This is the table of the heavenly feast, the joyful celebration of the people of God. Jesus said, I am the bread of life. All who come to me shall not hunger, and all who believe in me shall never thirst.
Let us pray. Father God, we come this morning thanking you, God. You are so faithful. Lord, in all the storms this morning, what was on my mind is the faithfulness of God. Your weather comes for a purpose, for a reason, and Lord, we accept that. You are a sovereign God. Lord, we thank you for giving your son Jesus to die on the cross for us. That all we have to do to receive salvation is to acknowledge and believe and confess that he died for us. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for the invitation to come to the table. Lord, we come with open hearts. Lord, we come praising and thanking you for forgiving our sins, for loving us in spite of us. We thank you, and we thank you for this invitation to the table. It's in your precious name that we pray. Amen. right in the upper room, took the bread, blessed it, shared it. This represents his body that was given for you. Take. And he lifted the cup with the wine, the blood, representing the blood that was given for you and for me. Drink ye, all of you. And all of God's people say, amen.
Thank you. hallelujah. This is the way that we give praises to our God. Make a joyful noise, all ye land. Let's make some noise for the Lord this morning. Let's praise him this morning. He's worthy. He's worthy. He's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. Praise his name from the rising of the sun to the going down of the same. I come from a noisy crowd. Amen. God be praised. Amen. Amen. Let me ask you, if this is your first time worshiping at Brentwood Baptist Church, we're going to ask that you would stand that we might recognize you this morning. If it's the first time here, please stand. First time here, please stand. Amen. There are some over here. Amen. Remain standing. Remain standing. One right here. Remain standing until someone has put a visitor's card in your hand. After you've received the visitor's card in your hand, you may then be seated. Come on, let's get some cards, y'all. God, I know we got some somewhere. There you go. Thank you. Amen. Then you may be seated. We are so glad to have you this morning. We want to thank you for passing up other churches, coming through the threatened rain and storm that they forecast, but it didn't turn out like that, did it? Hallelujah, somebody. But you made it. Hey, let's give them a hand for making it. Amen. Amen. And I want to say right quick, if the person that invited you is here, we want them to stand. Who invited you? Are they here? You stand. Who invited you? Amen. Amen. Thank you, ma'am. Who invited y'all over here? Are they here? Somebody here? Nobody. Well, thank you for making it on your own then. Hallelujah. Let's sure enough give them a big hand. Amen. The card that was placed in your hand, we're going to ask you to fill that card out, the bottom portion, fill that card out on both sides. Those around you, they'll make sure that you have something to write with. They're going to make sure that so you can fill both sides out. Then tear the bottom portion off, and when the offering plate passes in a few moments, place that completed bottom portion of that card in the offering plate, and we'll be sure to be in touch with you in days to come. Amen? Amen. I want to let you know you're in the right place at the right time. God has a special blessing with your name on it in this place this morning. We need you to do one thing. Keep your spiritual antennas up so you won't miss the blessing that God has in store for you. Amen? Amen. Amen. Now, let me say this. Let me get out of here. Now, I want you to know why we're here as a church. We're here because we have a mission. Our mission statement declares that Brentwood exists to serve the kingdom of God and to extend the gospel of Jesus Christ by doing three things. Let's all stem together. By number one, reaching people. Number two, developing believers. And number three, strengthening missions. Amen. So that's why we're here this morning. Amen. So I want you to know that's why we're here this morning. Now, I'm going to sit down. I need everybody to do one other thing, and I'm not going to ask you to stand. Don't stand. Don't stand. I want you to give your best smile to those on your right and your left and tell them it's so good to be sitting beside you this morning. Give them your best smile. Don't get up. Don't get. Amen. Amen. We want everybody to feel good here and do good because we are the church where Christ is.
However many teeth you have, that was good. Good smile. That's a good smile. On this first Sunday of each quarter, we stand to invite you to demonstrate your tithe, your commitment. We are always excited and we're always appreciative of you who have obeyed the word. The tithe is an act of obedience. It's not how much you give. It's not equal giving. It is equal sacrifice. And so we do thank you because each quarter we find ourselves bringing our tithes and offering. We usually pass the plates. We will ask you in a moment to stand and bring your tithe. The deacons are in place, and we'll be prepared to receive your gift. Then we will pass the plates once that has been completed for missions, for everybody to participate in missions. And then for those who did not participate in the tithe, the second plate will be passed for the regular offering. Let's pray. Because you have been faithful to us, we attempt to be faithful to you. We attempt in obedience to trust you, Lord. And so we thank you. It ain't about gimmicks. It's not about trying to hit budgets. It's about the fact that you told us that on the first day of the week that we should bring our tithe. And you promised some things with that, that you would open up windows of heaven and pour out blessings that we cannot contain. Bless us now. Bless the people of God as they participate in missions and for causes outside of this church. We give you thanks. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Would you stand and would you come? You can't beat God giving no matter how hard you try. The more you give, the more he gives to you. God bless you.
This morning. First of all, we want to thank you for supporting the Making Great Men's Empowerment Breakfast. Amen. It was a great success on yesterday, so thank you so much. We want to invite you out this Wednesday at 7 p.m. for a Bible study. Our teacher will be Dr. John Adolf in person. All right. Amen. All right. Pastor of the Antioch Baptist Church in Beaumont, and he's the author of I'm Changing the Game. We invite you to come out. It's been an awesome study thus far. And so we're expecting a great message from Dr. Adolf. The children's gala, etiquette classes and gala, which will be held on Sunday, April the 30th at 1 p.m. Today is the last day to register your children, pre-K through fifth grade. They have a table in the foyer. I think last report they had 8 slots available for that class. Amen? The Rose Mammogram Unit will be here Saturday, April the 15th from 9 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. For every 3 insured persons that are tested, 1 uninsured person will be tested for free. So we encourage you to please come out and support this event. Our scholarship fashion show will be held Sunday, May the 21st at the Hilton Americans Houston Hotel. The theme this year is Out of Africa. Tickets are available in the foyer. So we want to thank you, Brentwood, for all of your past support and making it possible for so many youth to pursue an education of higher learning. The Children's Ministry will host an Easter egg hunt on Saturday, April the 15th from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. Toddlers will be in the CCD and pre-K through fifth grade will be at the LLC. We are accepting donations of plastic eggs, individually wrapped candy, and monetary donations. This year, we've decided not to do boiled eggs because we have learned that there are different concepts of hard boiled. In addition, our children are really after the plastic eggs with the candy, amen? But we do have a table in the foyer, and today is the last day to make those donations. The Brentwood Community Foundation will host a scholarship application workshop today at 12:30 p.m. in the Lifelong Learning Center. You will learn how to apply and submit applications for scholarships and grants. So we encourage you to please go over with your youth at 12:30. Amen? We want to make you aware that funeral services for Rudy Williams, she is the mother of Dr. Drake Williams, who is a professor at Prairie View University and works with our AIDS ministry. The funeral will be April the 5th, and the viewing will be from 9 to 11. The funeral services will start at 11. We ask that you keep him in your prayers. Leroy and Connie Rogers, are you here? Would you stand? Let's join them in celebrating 49 years of marriage. Amen. There is hope. There is hope. Amen. Amen.
All right, I'm supposed to be a commercial. All righty. Good morning. How many of you remember hearing this? Think back to where you were when this song first came on, and you thought about how it could have been you outdoors. But then as you were driving, you took your hands off the wheel and lifted it up and said, thank you, Lord, for all you've done for me. That is the wonderful voice of Bishop Yvette Flunder. She sang with the Walter Hawkins Singers back in the day. And so she will be here on April the 12th, Wednesday night, for our pre-Easter praise and worship concert. Amen. Turn it up just a little bit more. They're not quite feeling that. And then, the other voice that you're used to hearing is almost here. How many of y'all know that? Bishop Carlton Pearson. He will be here also. You familiar with the Azusa Street Experience? He will be here singing these songs and many others from his hit albums on Wednesday, April the 12th. And we're asking that you come out, bring your friends, your relatives, your associates, your neighbors, and your frenemies. That's the new word that the millennials taught me. It's a friend that's an enemy, and an enemy that's a friend. So frenemies, bring those too. They need Jesus too. Amen. Also, after we get finished with all of that on Friday, 12 noon, we'll be in the sanctuary where we're going to have that great noonday service, and we're going to be packed in there sitting real, real tight and real, real close and loving on one another at 12 noon. And we will have communion on that day as well. And then on Sunday morning, just as Jesus got up and they went to the tomb, he was not there, somebody's going to call your house and you're not going to be there, because you're going to be here at Brentwood Church 6 o'clock in the morning for sunrise service. Amen. So we have service on that day at 6 o'clock, 8 o'clock, and 10 o'clock. And we look forward to you being here.
Encourage one another. Beginning and the end,
rejoice.
You were created to praise
and to
rejoice. Come on, come on, come on. Ow. Y'all don't want to quit. You don't want to stop. Oh, come on, come on. Hey, when the praises go up, the blessings come down. Oh, your blessing is in your praise. Come on and praise him. Praise him. Not because of what he's done, but because of who he is. Come on, come on. Praise him.
Your blessings
are on the way. Your blessings
are on the way.
Come on, come on, come on, come on and praise him.
Book of Luke, chapter 24, verse 28. And they drew nigh unto me, unto the village whither they went, and he made as though he would have gone further. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is far spent. And he went in to tarry with them. And it came to pass, as he sat at meat with them, he took bread and blessed it and brake and gave to them. And their eyes were open, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight. And they said one to another, Did not our heart burn within us while he talked with us by the way, and while he opened to us the scriptures? And they rose up the same hour and returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 gathered together and them that were with them, saying, The Lord is risen indeed and have appeared to Simon. And they told what things were done in the way and how he was known of them in breaking the bread. As we commune today, it is the mundane concerns of Christians as we remind ourselves of the act of grace that was done on our behalf. The bread, and then the blood. I want to focus on this bread. For bread is seldom just bread. The unleavened bread of the Exodus was a symbol of haste in the flight from Egypt. No yeast, just unleavened bread. Leavened bread then becomes a symbol of our sin. In the wilderness, God provided Israel with manna from heaven, which met the people at the center of two basic needs, a hunger for food, and a hunger for the presence of God. The temptation of Jesus to change stones to bread in the midst of a 40-day fast, in the midst, this seems to represent the place of physical appetite in the spiritual nature. While the 40 days is a definite reminder of the 40 days that they spent in the wilderness. Why not tempt God to turn straw into gold? But no, turn stones into bread. This definite trick on physics would impress all who were present. But why not the multiplication of loaves and the feeding of the multitudes and the sequential identification of Jesus in John as the bread which comes down from heaven? Reflect on both the physical and the spiritual hungers of life. The unleavened bread of the Passover became the symbol of the body of Christ in the Lord's Supper. And finally, the risen Christ was known to the disciples on the Emmaus Road in the breaking of the bread. He had held conversation, had been in their presence. But when he broke the bread, how he broke the bread, they said, "Ah, it is Jesus." And as quickly as they identified him, he vanished. When Jesus taught us to pray, "Give us this day our daily bread," nothing before and nothing after connects. It is a prayer that isolates the believer to understand that God invites us and asks him to give us daily bread, not for the future, but for this day. It becomes critical for the basic facts of life to be able to understand, as I preached a couple weeks ago about the paradox of anxiety, how we all borrow from it and we all draw from it, beginning to understand how we are anxious normally today about something tomorrow. We need bread. On the surface, the petition for bread identifies a basic human need that everyone can understand and appreciate. Are we not consumed by our need for bread? Not just enough to keep us well, but enough for a long and comfortable retirement. In this colloquial sense, bread then takes on money. And you begin to need bread, even that kind of bread. The difference between us begins to challenge us at the level that the church is the... I was in conversation with a business friend of mine, and the concept was made that the church is the biggest... It's a big business in the world. And he began to talk about how, as a personnel officer, how many young people come in interviewing for a job, worried more about their retirement, what are the benefits, than they are just for the salary. And he wondered why young people needed to be so burdened about the very distant future. And I thought about what Jesus told us: do not be worried about tomorrow, for tomorrow will bring worries of its own. Today's trouble is enough for you to handle. The challenge to our anxiety comes within the same address, in the same chapter, as the prayer for daily bread, with the acknowledgement that the Father will deliver and will give us everything we need. So give us this day our daily bread. As we commune, let us not lose sight of the significance of what the body of Christ is and how it was broken and for us. Through physical death, one reinforced the importance of spiritual side of life. Most of us could stand to adopt the practice of fasting for the sake of physical health. we're probably more in need physically and spiritually of fasting than we are of food. I guess I'm talking to myself. However, involuntary fasting through famine or war can be a terrible barrier to the deeper hunger of the soul. Number two, we do not live by bread alone. Wow. We need bread, but we do not live by bread alone. We have needs that far exceed the demands of our stomachs. Give us this day our daily bread. Jerome, the great theologian of early years, argued that he was certain that wanting tomorrow's bread was a reach, that most of us want. The bread and water of life had long been associated with paradise, and that Jesus looked forward to one day inviting you to dine. Come and dine in heaven where bread would be there. I got into a conversation with an associate pastor over the terrible taste of the commercial bread that we use at the Lord's Supper. This set us off into experiments with a common loaf, as many Episcopal groups use, or kosher mocks, or finally back to the little boxes of white plaster that threaten your teeth and stick in your throat. Here we are asking you to eat all of it. I've never gotten enough to eat at the Lord's Supper. But I've been fed in ways that no food could begin to satisfy. Maybe the taste of the bread is not as important as the meaning of the bread. That God gave us his son, who gave us his life. And that body was whipped with many stripes. Every time we commune, we do it as often as we can. He said that his food is to do the will of God. My goodness. How often have we been at a dining room table and somebody said, pass the bread, please. Not only is it enough for us to get the bread, but then we need to ask God to help us. Pass the bread, please. This casual, almost unconscious request at the family table becomes the primary concern of the church. That God wants us not just to do it as symbolic or even in reality, but he asks us to pass the bread, please. Our food pantry feeds hundreds every week, and I cannot thank those volunteers enough coming out and preparing those bags for people. Parts of our ministry go down to St. John, downtown, the Methodist Church, and work with what they call the Bread of Life program. And they feed homeless people downtown. We got the bread part in the physical down. You know, Baptists love to meet to eat. Y'all be, are they serving anything? Or they got any? That's we Baptists love to eat. So we got the bread part down. Would you pass the bread, please? It's not enough for you to satisfy the hungry who are hungry for food. But that, oh, I remember John, the gospel writer, would always give the autobiographical descriptions that Jesus had of himself. I am the way, I am the truth, I am life. But then he said, I am the bread of life. Hear me, church. Will you pass the bread, please? How many of your friends, you quickly give them something to eat, but and you share. But when it comes down to him who is the bread of life, here you keep it to yourself. Here you won't share it. I'm guilty myself. I'm on a plane every week going somewhere, and some days I just don't feel like talking about the Lord, talking about the bread. There I will be in first class, and someone, white boy, sit beside me and say, what do you do for a living? And I'll tell him I'm a dope dealer. Because I know if I say I'm a preacher, a conversation will continue and continue, and I want to go to sleep. Lord, forgive me for not passing the bread. Who knows, that brother could have been in trouble and needed a word, needed a conversation to speak to his spiritual need for bread. I now know what the old deacons meant when they said, guide me, O thy great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. I am weak, but thou art mighty. Hold me with thy powerful hand. And then they said, bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Will you please, please, please pass the bread? The message of God and our need for the daily bread. The day may come when we will be as dependent on our children as they were on us. Just as our parents fed us bread in our early years, many will live to the point where the roles will be reversed, and we too will have to give them that bread. Jesus allowed stubborn, independent Peter a glimpse into the future when he would be dependent on others. We cannot ignore the connection to the repeated phrase, feed my sheep, feed my lambs, feed my sheep. And as fate would have it, may God, like the child who offered his lunch in response to the call of Christ to feed the multitudes, may he convict you and me to stop being stingy with the gospel. In the country, when you hadn't eaten, they say you got the white mouth. Y'all have been in the city too long, but they used to say that. Look like you got the white mouth. That means you ain't ate nothing. And there are friends in your fraternity, friends in your sorority, friends in your circles, friends, neighbors, relatives, oh my goodness, associates, my God, who need the bread. Will you please pass the bread? May you not be willing. May God help you, and as he had to help me, to be willing to share the gospel. And they didn't know who he was until he broke the bread. And then they said, that's Jesus. And that's what the world's going to say about us. This little robe don't mean nothing if I'm not willing to share the bread. Even when I don't have it on. Will you please pass the bread? Oh, my God. And there will be many, many, many people, your friends, your family, your relatives, your associates, your neighbors, who just been watching your bread, but you have refused to share. I've been reading all kind of diet books, and they tell me if I stayed off bread, I would be a better candidate for weight loss. Lord, give us this day our daily bread. Not enough for over yonder for later, but for now. And God will reward you for sharing. Because there's somebody right now that only you can reach with that bread. The world is hungry for the living bread. Let the Savior lift him up. Lift him up. And he said, if you do that, I'll draw all men unto me. Oh, my God. Will you? Won't you? Please. Pass the bread. That's the message for today. Amen. Is there one today? Is there one today who doesn't know Christ and the pardon of their sins? We're going to say that the doors of the church are open, but the ushers are going to close them and to prevent you from walking out them doors. So we open our hearts and we invite you to become a part of the family of God. If you're here today, we invite you to make a move this way. Amen. This morning.
By his grace, the hand of the Lord is knocking.
You're here today and don't know the Lord and the pardon of your sin.
Won't you let him in?
You're here today and don't have a church home. One more time.
The Spirit of the Lord is surely
in this place.
In this place, ready and willing to save you. By his grace, the hand of the Lord.
Let's all stand. Wednesday night, Dr. Adolph will be here To conclude the series that we've been studying, I invite you to come and to share with us on this Wednesday. We look forward to what God is going to do this whole month. It's been announced. It's been sent to you in print and all kind of media ways. I hope you will invite friends and relatives to come and share in the pre-Easter concert and the communion service on Friday and even on Easter. Now unto him, the bread of life. Bread of heaven, bread of heaven, feed us till we want no more. We need bread. But man cannot live by bread alone, but out of every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. Bless us now, and we will ever give you the praise. For we will not be ashamed to own you before men, but to share and break the bread in the name of Jesus. Will you pass the bread, please? Amen.